Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
My name is Jim Abbott. I've been in the graphics business since 98. And I started doing water slide decals for HO scale, low scale, you know, small scale stuff. And then in 2010, I got into the inch and a half scale and started building my own railroad at the house. And shortly thereafter, I met up with Scott Weatherford. And we instantly hit it off and became great friends. And it was a great loss when we lost him. But he's the one that got me into, he gave me the idea to start doing vinyl. And I started doing all of his vinyl for his cars. And then West Bend Rail Car, Dave Gerke, started doing a lot for him. And I decided to just start doing it commercially. So offering it to everybody that wanted good decals. I mean, there really wasn't anybody in the market besides Connie Miracle that was doing it. So I started off small and just grew from there. And hooked up with another few companies like Reading Car Company, which owns this car here. And doing work for, you know, Train Works in Washington State. Then I have done some work for Backyard Train Company in Denver and stuff like that. But anyway, today I'm going to explain my way of applying vinyl, because everybody has their own preference of the way they do it. I do the dry transfer. A lot of people will use a transfer aid adhesive. Something like this, the Sure Glide. They'll spray it on so you can reposition the decal if you need to. If you don't get it quite right, you can pull it off and reposition it. I don't like to use that because it tends to leave bubbles underneath. So my way of doing it, clean the surface first, make sure, let's see. You clean the surface, make sure you use a grease pencil, something that's not going to leave a permanent mark on your surface, to mark, you know, measure down, mark where your lines are going to be. And it all, you know, measure twice, three times before you actually apply the vinyl. So, first thing. Well, this car is going to be a Terminal Railway Alabama State Docks car. And this particular car has a lot of vinyl that goes over ribs. So, obviously you need a good diagram to go by and some prototype pictures. With all my decals that go over ribs, I'll put guide marks where the ribs are.
That's cool.
So, like, say this will, be over here, but this will start here. You drop it down in, over, and back up, and it should line up with the next rib over. Well, I luck. That's why you need hyper accurate measurements on your ribs for me to do the decals and make sure everything is going to line up. So, with any luck, this is the first time I've done one of these cars. So, but I've done the rail box that's up top there, up by our booth. Heather Swinnerton, she did that car with my decals, and they lined up good. So, I should have the right measurements.
Hey Jim, what do you use to clean the? What do you recommend to use to clean it before you?
I use Spray Away. You buy this at Napa. It's
you buy it
easy,
anywhere.
I get my Napa, but you can use 409. Anything that gets any oils off. Don't use alcohol. Because alcohol will, if you got a glossy surface, alcohol will take that sheen right away. And you might have a mess on your hands. So, first thing to do, best thing, is lay out all your decals to make sure you have everything for the side of the car that you need and nothing's missing. And sometimes these bags can be pretty full of little stuff, so you've got to be pretty careful. And if it's a windy day, don't do it.
Please don't do it.
Unless you want to chase your vinyls down the road, yeah.
Yeah.
I highly recommend doing it inside the house where the air conditioning is, and my wife's kitchen table makes a great decaling
stuff. No. You mean you in the house?
Only the decal.
Yep.
And what's she was the decal?
And my monthly shower. she is the decaler. I'd spell it wrong, even though Jim puts it on the paper right. I constantly lose my squeegee.
I put it in, sometimes I put it in the pocket. I don't remember which pocket I put it in. I'm constantly searching for it. But use a good quality masking tape.
What?
This here I got at Napa. It's painter's tape. But as long as it peels off the roll good, a lot of times the stuff will peel off sideways or whatever. But I'll take, let's see, what's the first one? Okay. First thing you can do is put this up. Right where you're working, so you can see what you're doing. This here, you'll notice some of the letters are stretched,
mm-hmm.
where they go up over the ribs.
Yep.
So that's why you need hyper accurate measurements. So.
Otherwise, the letter would be very narrow.
Yeah. And that it does happen.
Yeah.
You know.
I mean, the prototype was obviously painted on, so
right.
That's why they had no problem like that.
Now, for this one, that is. On this particular one, I have these black. The top of the black is lined up right with the top of the rib. So. It's easy to line each and lettering up. So we need to
So you adjusted the size of the backing so that it helps you align to the car, so it's got a little extra margin to like line it up, as you said, to the top of the car.
Yeah, this is made so that way. This will line up right at the top edge of
that. That is very nice.
Smart.
So when I go across, with any luck, it should stay. And start, I usually start from the right hand, do the right hand side because I'm right handed. So, on the ones that go over ribs, make sure your vinyl is sealed down to the release paper. Now, sometimes this can be a chore. Peel this back to that point, to the center one.
Okay.
And then I'll work both directions. So, my scissors. And I will.
Now, Jim, what are you doing right now?
I'm cutting the backing paper off just to this side of the that right there, the center mark.
Yeah.
So when you put this on the rib, this side will not go and stick to the car right away. So it's here.
I could probably clean the car from there. That's
okay, it's Russ's, don't worry about it. Yeah, you know.
Yeah,
I
think
it's so humid.
Yeah.
Dry. Yourself to the machine or anything. Top and bottom.
So right now you're lining up the center.
There's a lot of eyeball into this as well as measure. But
you don't see much.
Looks pretty good there. So that's now rather than use your squeegee, just use your finger to start with. To start down over the rib. Once it's started, push it down over the rib.
Does it stretch at all?
The vinyl will stretch, but the release paper will not. So, let me look. If that is square to this corner, that should go right straight across. See, I'm leaving the release paper up while I'm going across. That'll eliminate any bubbles that would go underneath it. And that should.
Yeah, nice.
Well, lines up pretty close. But where there's two separate, I did them two separate pieces, you can adjust that now.
So it gives you some flexibility to make adjustments to.
Sometimes when you have a decal that covers solid right across the wall, a few different ribs, that's when it can get a little bit dicey.
The rail box I had to cut in half.
Yeah, rail box.
Yeah.
And then this side, peel this side back. You need to go all the way back with it at first so you can hold it like that. Side down. And having a felt side squeegee like this slides on this release paper really nice.
Yep.
And the plastic side drags a lot. So it's a lot harder to, for me anyway. I like this the felt ones for this particular purpose. Across.
Okay.
It's off just a little bit, see that?
Yeah.
So this one wasn't quite accurate. I don't think it's going to make the difference. Ribs are tricky. It did go off just a little bit. Get back there.
I
down just a little bit. Sometimes it's the luck of the draw. And if you ever screw something up like this and order it from me, I'll recut it for you and send it to you. No problems. Sometimes it does happen.
As you're peeling the release paper away, and before you're actually, I saw you're kind of guiding your letters down. Will they have a tendency of wanting to live with the paper?
Sometimes. They will. Okay. They will. If you're not, that's why you have to really, if it starts to lift on you, put the release the paper back down and rub it some more. And try it again. See, the E started to lift on me. That's what I did. I pushed it back down. It started to get it back so it stuck to it. I may have to. I'd cut an extra one of those just in case. I may have to replace that. But this one has four. Oh, yay.
Suck it up, Buttercup.
Would you ever cut that and say, okay, I'm going to do this one in two pieces?
Well, when I laid it out, there's really no way to do this one. Oh, actually, I could. I could have. Maybe A. The Y goes up onto the rib. So, yeah, I probably could cut this right here and do it. It's probably a good idea. Good idea.
There we go.
Sometimes I miss it.
The good thing is that there's a grip pattern that makes it easy to cut on the back too. Oh.
Sound good.
Where is this one?
The next one.
Right beside the.
Oh, right next to it. Okay. Yeah.
I don't know if you can see the guide up there.
Sorry, the
text beside it.
Here.
Why is it called release paper if it's made
plastic? Is it really? Whoa, there's a hole there. All right, who brought the gopher?
It was rain.
Yeah, release papers releases the lettering off the backing paper, so it just called release paper, so it releases the. This is the backing paper, this is the release paper, so you keep that one. That's why they call it that, I guess. Let's
it's on the table.
Of course it is. Uh-huh. What was that?
What happened if somebody goofed up on putting the ribs on there?
Well, that could be.
It would never
be. I doubt it. These have slots in behind here, so these just, they're already pre-engineered for that. So they should be all the right spacing. Is this how you do it, Heather?
Yeah, sure.
Whatever it takes, right?
So you have to be pretty patient, obviously.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes patience is one of my virtues. Mm-hmm.
Do you put a spray coating over those once you're done of any kind?
You can, but you don't need to.
Okay.
Weather too long. It'll take them forever to weather. Yeah. And you want them to weather. So you know what? I always have a new car, right? You don't want a new looking car after right around.
Yeah.
If she leaves the park in the state too long, somebody might put gravel and get
up. Hell yeah, yeah.
I could not work on the space.
Huh?
I know a friend of mine
had an offer that was used, and he had people spray paint designs on
more original.
I said, now is that called railroad art?
Yeah.
One of the guys in Oshkosh had a car, and he happened to know one of the guys who was doing the spray painting on the railroad to the graffiti. He went and paid the guy to do his car.
He works so much.
Yeah. Did you see that car floating around the club the other morning? I don't know where it came from. He got another trouble a while back. That's a good couple of rounds for him. We're out there. Such a very good. But he ain't going to
standpoint of measuring, I assume you pre-measured that so you knew how far to go down?
Yeah, let me be so they lined up on the top of these.
Okay.
Normally I would have to measure down, but I try to save time. Just starting to peel.
Yeah.
Go back in and make sure it's going to stay there. And just go slow with it. It's best to do it on like a 45 degree angle. Right down next to the paper, that will help it transfer a lot better.
Yeah.
Try to pull it straight off.
It's just more resistance. Don't lift it straight up. Like, we'll just take it off.
Yeah. Looking straight on at it.
Yeah, that looks great.
Yeah. So I have a question. How would you handle rivets?
Rivets, yes.
Fun.
I have this tool right here that I use for rivets.
Let me guess, it's called a rivet tool?
Yeah, it's called a rivet roller.
No kidding.
Yeah, it's a roller pro vinyl application roller, basically.
And since vinyl stretches, it's a special
roller. A soft rubber here. These are running around $50, $55. But if you're doing a lot of rivets, they're well worth it. And there's YouTube videos on how to use these. But basically, if you have a row of rivets, you'll take the vinyl and put it up over the rivet and just leave an air gap. All the way up over, all the way up the rivet line.
Yeah, I understand.
And once you get everything else applied, peel off your release paper, take a heat gun, start from the center, and work up and work down. Very, very light heat, not a lot, just enough to make the vinyl pliable, and start in the center and just roll up and down. Just keep rolling until it forms around the rivets.
Your wife's hair dryer.
So it'll like stretch.
Yeah. You can use a hair dryer too. It just takes a little longer sometimes. But these are definitely a handy little tool to have. For welded cars like this, you don't really need them for it.
Do you have those for sale, Jim?
I don't. I don't have those.
Is there a particular place to get it online? Or?
I got this one off eBay, actually. But there are companies that sell them. Or you can go right to Roller Pro and order them direct. So. Yeah,
well, sorry, what was it called again?
It is called a Roly Pro Vinyl Application Roller.
I see.
Aim that in the camera.
Yeah. And they're looks like they're licensed by 3M, so you know they're good. I don't have to finish this one up right at the moment. I'll work on the logo. What's that? Oh, these here, you just peel them off. Just like, just start with your, thumbnail or whatever, and.
Because you didn't roll those, you didn't squeegee them.
Back. Yeah, you do. You can squeegee them on. You don't have to, but so just peel it off. Easy.
Now, after you've done the loose paper, you don't go and press on that.
You don't have to. After this comes off, you don't have to do anything with it. You may want to go over it to see if there's anything that's risen around the corners. You can just push it down with your fingers or lightly with the squeegee. But yeah, once it's there, it should stay there.
Does the glue on that set up more over time?
Yes. Yes.
About how long?
Oh, within a month, it'll be a lot harder to get them off. So if you make a mistake, you can peel them off right away. It's very easy.
Do you recommend doing it? Are there any temperature humidity guidelines?
Don't do it in the bright sun.
Yep.
I had that mistake. I was working on a Conway Scenic Dallas car up in North Conway, New Hampshire. And I had the other style of release paper. It's kind of a paper backing, kind of a milky color. And I was doing it in the bright sunlight. That stuff, it came off like glue. I mean, it was just pieces peeling it off instead of a sheet. Because once the sun got at it, it heated it up. But yes, keep it inside if you can. Obviously, sometimes you can't.
On a dinner table is preferable.
Yeah, a dinner table,
Depends
just
who you ask.
Just what you hear.
Yeah. It helps to have an understanding wife.
Yes, exactly. Very much so.
How long can you save into it this?
These are probably good for a couple of years.
Really? They won't set up?
No. I mean, they will eventually. If you let them set for more than 3 or 4 years, the decal itself will stick right to the backing paper, and you won't be able to get it off very easily. Especially if you have little letters, if you try to peel that off, the letters will come right, will stay right on the backing paper. And it's a pain in the neck. So, keeping them fresh is the best thing. Don't order them until you need them. Because at that point, you'll know what your measurements are going to be anyway, so. I do have measurements for, factory-made cars, or factory, I call it factory-made, like Precision Steel, Titan. I have diagrams for most of that stuff. So so I can pretty much tell what your car's going to need. Just need your road name and specific road number or whatever. I can pretty much take care of the rest of it. Now this logo here looks kind of funky. But once it's over the ribs, it'll look correct with any luck.
In theory.
So. Put that
in. So when you design this, Jim, you have to know what your rib thickness, not only width,
oh,
but
yeah,
also
width, height, you know, that's why you got to have
spacing
really good.
Right.
Yeah, these are half inch wide, 3/8 deep, something like that. Because everybody makes their stuff a little different. So kind of has to be done on a 1x1 if it's a custom car. So let's see, we want to do one set first.
Did you clean the surface of the car there?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Good idea. I forget that quite often actually.
Why is my decal?
I get too excited about doing the car. It's like, oh crap, I forgot.
Why is my decal peeling off?
After I get it all measured up and everything, I get it taped on, it's like, oh, I forgot.
Joe, start sticking them on and then find out you
got
that.
Uh-huh. Yeah. It's bad when you're doing a prototype car. I've done quite a few. And then you forget that once you're halfway done with the logo. It's like, uh-oh.
I just did it.
I'm
going to paint it.
Yeah, no problem. It's also have the contamination.
So, Jim, when someone orders a decal from you, and it's not, let's say, a standard car, let's say they home built it, right?
Yeah.
What's all the information that you need for them to
The way I design my decals, I actually take your measurements and I'll draw your car right on my screen. And then at that point, I'll need height, length, rib spacing, door width, sometimes on the ends, depending on where your ribs fall. But for the most part, just basic measurements. I don't need, you know, to rebuild the car. I just need to build the basic shape on the screen. Once I have the rib dimensions, I'll take the, if it's a logo like this one, I'll take it apart. Once I have I do the complete logo as it would look as if you're looking at it on the car. And then I would take the logo off the screen, doing a different part of the car, or a different part of the screen of the car, cut it apart electronically, you know, in my, I use CorelDRAW, spread it apart, and then fill in all the spaces, put it back, weld it back together. So that gives you hopefully the correct shape once it goes on the car.
And if there's a lot of rivets on the car, do you compensate for that at all? Or
you don't need to. Because this vinyl stretches, so it'll stretch down over rivets, no problem. I use high performance vinyl for everything I do, where, you know, some other manufacturers use, you know, indoor vinyl basically. So this is stuff you'd use on real freight cars or real, you know, truck doors or anything. So.
How long should the paint cure before you put the decal
on? If you're painting it with automotive paint, I'd let it set for probably a week. As long as you can't smell it, you're good. If you can still smell the paint, it's probably not a good idea.
What about if you want to clear coat it after, like a dull coat or something?
You're totally fine clear coating this.
Right away?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, then there's no setup time like water slide decals. So, you can coat it with anything. You can use a lacquer. I don't know if... It all depends on what you painted it with, I guess. I've had people ask me that before. They've coated with different products and they've never had anything curl or peel or with this type of vinyl. So, and if it's powder coated, like these are, once you get it back from the powder coaters, you're all good to go anyway. So, how much time we got about it?
You're pretty good, actually.
Right. Yeah, no, 10:30?
Yeah. 10:37, so you got time.
So, well, let's see if we can do something with this a little bit. This one. Yeah.
Let's put it in the center.
There.
Grab this wide up paper towel.
The paper towel by the way of the camera.
You don't need to set it down. Don't set it down like that. Don't ask me how I know.
Unless you want to have the logo on the top of the car.
Like dust on your logo? Underneath your logo?
Well, no, it's you a weird, stick to whatever you
want. It's a weird place to put your logo.
Always keep your instructions where you can see them. Just in case. Heather, can you come here, man? Yeah.
There you have it. Having two people is better than one.
Yeah, sometimes.
At least for the start.
Let's see.
Or you just throw an extra pair of hands.
Oh. From the professional.
I'm on the side, so it all looks crooked.
Just for that, you're going to finish this car back in the
end. We can move the car to the back, no problem.
I still got to finish the pool quarter.
She'll just tell anybody who sees a mistake on it that you did it.
It's on video, everybody knows it.
Uh-oh.
You lost his instructions.
Oh, that'll do it now.
Uh-oh, now I can't do it.
That's why it's crooked.
You got a tough audience here.
Oh, I know.
I have to be careful. I'll be giving a presentation later.
Oh, you have a presentation.
off just a little bit. I must not have had the right measurements for those ribs.
Slacker.
Slacker. Who's slacking?
I didn't get the measurements, so probably it's the one I'm not here.
It's all Zach's fault.
We'll blame it on Russ. He's not here to blame it.
The importance of getting the right measurements, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Because it's kind of hard to take one of these cars, put it in a box, and ship it to me.
So you're kind of at the whim of what the measurements people give you.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So Jim, if we had like an AutoCAD drawing of what we're doing, could we just send that to you to save you some time? And
well, unfortunately, AutoCAD won't import into Corel. I've tried.
Unless it's a DXF.
I've tried it. I've tried everything.
Okay.
It won't work.
Really?
No.
Is CorelDRAW able to open SVGs?
Yes.
Okay.
For the most part. But if you, it all depends on what it's created in. It needs to be created in a vector format, and AutoCAD's not vector.
And my CAD software actually exports in the right format. I can open it in CorelDRAW and in...
But you're using Libre.
We got to get together and figure this out then. I've tried everything.
Well, I'm just saying, I'm using a Libre. You could import the model into a Libre first and then export it from there.
I have Libre, yeah.
So
I use that as the intermediary.
Yeah. You got to have a conversion.
It's like Adobe Illustrator will not import into Corel. But if you save it as an EPS, I can.
Well, I'm not surprised that nothing with Adobe works at all. So I'm not trying to get away from Adobe products for years.
Everybody wants their own. Everybody's used their own.
I use a lot of Inkscape because it's open source, free.
Yeah.
So.
Inkscape files will work.
I have to scoot over to the center commander scene from the front because.
Well, look, all right, expert.
Boy, that looks pretty
good.
From our angle, it still looks weird, but we have to look forward. Yes.
Yeah, wait a minute. It's about a hair width too narrow.
Yeah. Wait a minute. He's asking the woman up here, and she's the boss.
She's the boss?
You've been talking to Russ, have you?
Yep. Make sure everything is working.
Yeah, kind of makes sense. If the measurement is even slightly off, you will have an error accumulating the further you go down.
Yep. That's why I like to start in the middle and work both ways.
Yeah.
That way you have a little bit of error in both directions.
Start to steal.
Now, is this actually two layers of vinyl, one black and one white, on top of each other?
Okay. Right. These here, I don't have a vinyl printer, so I do my multicolored logos in layers. So I'll cut the white oval, and then I'll cut the black, weed that out, and I use registration marks and overlay it. So the vinyl gets a little thicker that way. But it's really, this is the printed ones are okay for a while, but after a while they tend to fade.
Yeah, so the ink fades,
So I prefer doing it this way. If you have a real multicolored logo, then printing is the way to go.
The weeding is the most tedious process, I think.
That it is. When you get real small, is anything real small?
No.
Like loop plates. That lettering gets pretty bad sometimes.
Wow.
Yep.
Yep.
So, I do all these individually. So I'll print it all, and I'll print the back black background, or cut it rather, cut the back the black background, and I'll cut the white and leave the outside ring and the letters.
Mm-hmm.
And then I can overlay it. I leave just a little bit of space underneath so I can cover it without, like, in case it misses
makes
a little
sense,
bit.
Yeah.
So, yeah, little things you learn over the years. Now I'll see if I can get this thing off here without making a mess. Starts to lift it all like it does right there. Just push it back in and rub it in for a minute. Keep doing it till it stays there.
Yeah, that paper has a second option. You can leave it laying around and catch the flies and bats.
That's why I put a clear sheet of vinyl over your little bit. I didn't have to worry about flies.
Now in this, I got a, like, if you ever get a little bubble, I got a little bubble right here. X-Acto knife, number 11 blade. Just kind of poke the area and rub it down with your finger. And just do it until that bubble disappears. You don't want to slice the decal, so it's just going to leave a gap. Eventually the decal might shrink a little bit, and that
gap
will open
bigger.
Up. So, little pricks ain't going to bother anything. So... For the most part, that's...
It's great.
Not too bad, huh?
Yeah.
Very nice. Oh, yeah. Any questions other than that? Well, yeah?
Does it hurt to preheat the decal with like a hair dryer if it's a little not pliable?
I think you would want to do
Depending on what temperature you're applying it at.
Yeah.
If it's a day like this, you don't need to. But if it's cooler, you know, you don't want to apply vinyl below 40 degrees.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Or when it's, you know, has a dew on it or anything like that, you would definitely want to get that stuff off.
I had the clothes of you putting a vinyl sticker on a card when it was really cool.
And I would assume you'd want your equipment and your vinyl to be the same temperature when you apply it.
Yes. Yeah, you want to keep all your vinyl in room temperature.
Probably the same room that the subjects left.
Yeah, it's not a bad idea.
For a while.
But
the
make
kitchen
sure
table.
If you're going to bring the car in from, you know, cold outside, let it warm up to room temperature first. Yeah.
Yeah.
Make sure the surface is the same. So.
How does it handle heat?
Fine.
No,
yeah,
I mean,
no problem.
What it's mounted to, like a locomotive steam.
Oh, I wouldn't apply it to the boiler.
Well, no, I mean...
But you wouldn't anyway.
Well,
but,
I'm going to talk to you about it later. There's a place I have one that is on a maybe rectangular on the sand dome, but that sits on the boiler.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that shouldn't be any problem at all.
Because it's more ambient air around it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, as long as it's not direct heat behind it,
yeah,
like the smoke box or something like that, you know, that's going to curl it.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty fast, but
the adhesive gets off the gun and then it just
They also make, I don't know if you want, you probably wouldn't want to use it on this scale, but if you ever need to take vinyl off of a truck door or something like that, 3M makes a wheel that go in the cordless drill. And you just work at the side of the door and take the vinyl, pretty much take it right off.
Oh, really?
Wow. But you have to be real careful you don't burn through the paint.
Yeah.
Is that a hard felt, that they call it?
It's a real hard rubber.
Oh, it's a rubber?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see how you leave a mark all down the way to the metal with that easily if you don't do it.
I mean, a powder coated car, you'd probably be all right doing that with, but I wouldn't do it on a regular painted car.
I took the logo off and the paint.
We're getting close to time. Does anyone have any other questions or anything like that?
Well, I guess just if you're doing a newer car, a car you don't have the graphics for, you know, something cool like this or, you know, like a weird font or something, what would we need to supply you with? A photo, or are you just tracing over photos? Or?
It's nice to have a good straight on side shot. Then I can put the photo right on the screen and trace the logo. But a lot of times I can find logos online.
A lot of other people.
Or if it is like a 3/4 shot, sometimes I can make it from scratch, but it's a lot easier if I have something that's straight on. And I pretty much know all the known measurements, like the reporting marks, and reporting marks usually 8 or 9 inch. The capacity data is always 3 inch. End data is 4 inch. So there's basic known measurements on a freight car that, you know, take a lot of guesswork out of it. It's logos and there are other lettering that can tend to get a little dicey at times, but it's all doable. So, all right, if anybody else has any questions?
If you had a long logo, you were going over all this ribs, would it be beneficial to put like a light pencil mark on there? You can,
because as you go, you might have to sit and actually look at, because you can adjust it up just a little bit.
You can pull up and down, but you want to make sure you're straight from one to the other.
Yeah.
If it's long, it's going
to
get...
It is going to be, because you're not going to know until you get to that point where that's off. So, yeah, like this dropped a little bit, probably about 16th of an inch. You can see it droop a little bit here.
I corrected the picture.
But it's always fixable. You just peel it off, do another.
All right. Well, thanks, Jim.
All right. Appreciate it.